The Grand Canyon is one of the most famous geologic features on Earth. But what's the geology of this incredible canyon? What do these amazing layers represent? How far back in Earth's history do they go? And how did the canyon itself get cut? Sure, this canyon is a beautiful sight to behold, but it's also an open textbook of Earth's past. The river that cut this canyon exposed all these ancient layers of rocks that get older as we go further down into the canyon. The Grand Canyon exposes nearly 2 billion years of Earth's history in its stunning layers. And these layers of rock are like pages in our textbook, each one telling a story about the environment in which it was deposited. So in this video, we're gonna walk through the geologic history of these amazing layers together. Let's go. Starting at the bottom of the canyon, the oldest rocks here are the Vishnu schist and Zoroaster granite, and some other metamorphic rock sequences that I'll put up on the screen here for you. Now, I'm standing very far away from these schists and these granites just because I only have one full day here, and you can't get to the bottom and back up of the canyon in one day, just for future reference if you're planning to come here. But these basement rocks are over 1.7 billion years old. And they represent ancient metamorphic and igneous rocks formed deep within Earth's crust. At this time, Earth's land masses were coming together in one of the earliest known supercontinents called Nuna or Columbia. Colliding tectonic plates at this time drove intense heat and pressure that formed the Vishnu schist, while intrusions of magma from below formed the Zoroaster granite. Life on Earth at that time was limited to single-celled organisms like cyanobacteria, which were producing oxygen, setting the stage for later animal life to evolve. Above the basement schist and granite, we have the Grand Canyon supergroup, a mix of sedimentary rocks deposited during the Proterozoic eon in a rift basin environment, which likely formed as the ancient supercontinent Nuna or Columbia broke up. These rocks were deposited 1.2 to 0.8 billion years ago, several hundred million years after the 1.7 billion year old rocks below it. So wait, where did all that time in between go? This is called an unconformity, when a period of non-deposition or erosion leads to missing time in the rock record. Don't worry, there are rocks on Earth that record this time in Earth's history elsewhere. They're just missing here due to local effects, and I'll get more to that later in the video. In any case, the Grand Canyon supergroup of rocks represent an incredible time in Earth history, when oxygen levels were rising leading up to Snowball Earth, a period or an ice age in which Earth became nearly completely covered in ice, which was immediately followed by the Ediacaran and Cambrian explosions of the first animal life on Earth. In fact, the very next set of rocks lying on top of this supergroup in many places in the canyon are sedimentary rocks from the Paleozoic era, which span from around 540 to around 250 million years ago. These layers include sandstone, shale, and limestone from the Cambrian period, like the Bright Angel Shale, which makes up most of the hilly, kind of gravelly-looking hills out there under the big red wall limestone. So all of that stuff that's super weathered is mostly Bright Angel Shale from the Cambrian period, during the time that animals were just evolving. And this is preserved here because at this time, North America was near the equator and covered by warm, shallow seas. Then, as we continue moving up the rock layers, we get to the red wall limestone, which I'm not standing right next to, but you can see it along this cliffside here, as well as pretty much anywhere if you look out into the distance in the Grand Canyon. There's a reason they named it the red wall limestone. It's pretty well named. And this big red wall of limestone, or the red wall limestone, aptly named, is actually not red limestone. Limestone typically is more white, tan, or gray, and this is actually no different, but it's just been stained red by the very iron-rich deposits above it. If you look out to the canyon, you can see the big cliff of red which is overlain by the thin layers of red above it. That's the supply group, which we'll get to in a second. But that supply group, if we come back over here, has stained this red limestone. And you can actually, I didn't actually really believe it until I checked. Don't tell anyone this, but I broke off a little piece here and you can actually see how bright it is. And then I also caught the piece that came off. That's the inside and that's the surface. So the whole surface and the whole canyon makes it look red just because of that thin layer at the surface. This limestone was deposited in a warm tropical marine environment in the Mississippian period, around 360 to 320 million years ago. Globally, this was a time of high sea levels and extensive reef ecosystems. But the reefs back then were completely different than those today for a couple of reasons. One, the corals that built reefs back then went extinct at the end of the Paleozoic. So the corals that we have today are a completely different group of corals than those that lived and built reefs during the Paleozoic era. And two, other organisms like sponges, cyanobacterial mats, and algae contributed more heavily to reef building at the time. So they weren't just coral reefs, they were more like everything reefs. This was around the time that plants had just spread onto land, and early amphibians were evolving from lobed fin fish. Then we get to the supai group, which has beautiful red siltstones, sandstones, and shales, and some minor limestone, which were deposited in the upper Mississippian to the lower Permian from around 320 to 280, 85 million years ago. And these rocks, these siltstones, sandstones, and shales, represent a period of fluctuating sea level. So they represent a variety of environments, from fluvial river environments to deltaic delta environments and other shallow marine depositional environments. And this represented the fluctuating sea levels of the time during the Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, and Permian. Then we get to the Coconino sandstone, which represents ancient desert dunes that formed in the Permian period around 350 to 250 million years ago. At this time, the supercontinent Pangaea was fully assembled, which led to massive deserts across its interior. So here we can see in this section, these striations, these kind of horizontal lineations or lines on the rock surface. But then you come down here and you can see this slanted one over here. And as we go further, you can see this one kind of cross cuts along these other striations. And then you see it continues to over there. And there's more sweeping and cross cutting over here. All of these incredible cross cutting features. This is called cross stratification or cross bedding. And because it's in sandstone, we know that this is probably representing those ancient Aeolian or desert dune environments of the late Permian, kind of mid to late Permian period that we talked about earlier. Also, reptiles had appeared by this time, as well as the early ancestors of mammals. Unfortunately though, this canyon doesn't preserve any post-mammal Earth history. The youngest rocks here are still over 250 million years old, but 2 billion years is still nearly half of Earth's history. So I'd say it still did pretty good. That said, there is some missing time between the rocks in this canyon, which gets a lot of attention. Yep, that's right. It's time we talk about the Great Unconformity. Like I mentioned earlier, unconformities are boundaries between rock layers that represent periods of either erosion or non-deposition. The Great Unconformity is so great because it's a gap of time that represents over a billion years. We can see it if we look down here into the canyon. Essentially, all the really deformed looking, you know, early kind of Precambrian metamorphic rocks down there right next to the canyon come up right against these flat layers of nice sedimentary rocks that are likely the sandstone of the Cambrian. Or at least in some areas of the canyon, it goes straight from Precambrian, Vishnu schist, you know, 1.7 billion year old rocks to Cambrian rocks, which are around 500 to 540 million years old. So that's over a billion years lost in time there. But keep in mind, this unconformity did not erase all the rocks that we have from that missing time period. We actually have some in the Grand Canyon itself, called the Grand Canyon Supergroup, from the Proterozoic time, that time in between 1.7 billion years ago and 500 million years ago, around 1.2 to 0.8 billion years ago. However, that Grand Canyon Supergroup is not preserved everywhere in the canyon. So where it isn't preserved, we have this boundary, which we call the Great Unconformity. But what caused this Great Unconformity to form? Where does it occur? And what erased all this rock? Well, the timing of this Great Unconformity, or the gap of time it represents, coincides with significant tectonic and climatic events, such as the breakup of the supercontinent Rodinia around 750 million years ago, and the subsequent Snowball Earth event, or near global ice age. There were two big glacial periods that we call the Snowball Earth period, or two Snowball Earth periods at this time, during which extensive erosion stripped away vast portions of Earth's crust, likely contributing to this Great Unconformity. But what about how the canyon itself formed? For a long time, scientists thought that the Colorado River began carving the canyon around 5 to 6 million years ago. But more recent evidence suggests that parts of the canyon could be much older, potentially up to 70 million years old, back when the dinosaurs roamed. At that time, during the late Cretaceous period, as dinosaurs thrived and flowers had just evolved, tectonic uplift driven by the Laramide orogeny, or mountain building event, uplifted this region, setting the stage for later erosion, such as the carving of this canyon. There are two main hypotheses for the timing of canyon erosion. The Young Canyon hypothesis suggests that the Colorado River carved the canyon within the last 6 million years. The Old Canyon hypothesis argues that different segments of the canyon formed independently over tens of millions of years and later merged. Recent research using thermochronology, measuring the thermal history or cooling of rocks, supports the idea that parts of the canyon are more ancient than others. So it's possible that ancient rivers began carving the canyon long before the Colorado River system took over. I think the fact that this is one of the most well-known geologic features on Earth, and we still don't know exactly when and how this canyon formed, makes it even more majestic, beautiful, and amazing. So we've gone through the layers exposed in this beautiful canyon, what they represent, and how the canyon was formed. But there are some other amazing facts about this canyon that I learned just before coming here that I just have to share. First, have you ever wondered how much water the Grand Canyon would hold if it was filled all the way up to the top? Apparently, it can hold 4.17 trillion metric tons of water, or about 1.1 quadrillion gallons of water. For comparison, this is over 10 times the annual flow of all rivers in the United States combined. And it would take the Colorado River over 200,000 years to fill this canyon to the top if no water escaped. 200,000 years, that's crazy. That said, to put this in perspective in the opposite way, that amount of water is still only 0.00059% of water in the Pacific Ocean. Just telling us how vast the oceans are compared to river systems. Okay, this is an impromptu fun fact because it's snowing. And so this impromptu fun fact is that this right here, this is the snow that's falling, or I guess you could call it ice, sleet, hail, I don't know. It's very soft. It's just very round, so it looks kind of like Dippin' Dots. But the fun fact is that because water, when it's solid as ice in its pure form, is a mineral, this snow is actually a rock, because snow is typically dirty. It has other impurities in it. And so it's not pure water, so it's not the mineral ice, but it is a rock. So these right here are rocks in the Grand Canyon that are being deposited right now. And unfortunately, they probably won't get preserved. Fun fact number three, the temperature at the bottom of the canyon can get up to 25 degrees Fahrenheit or 14 degrees Celsius hotter than at the top of the canyon due to the elevation difference. Fun fact number four, around 1.8 million years ago to around 500,000 years ago, volcanic eruptions in the region created lava dams, some of which blocked the river for thousands of years, creating temporary lakes that had sediment form in them, which you can still see today in some regions of the canyon. And there are lava flows and cinder cones preserved in the western part of the canyon that record this ancient volcanism. Unfortunately, we're nowhere near them right now, but they're there. Fun fact number five, it would take someone 100 days with no stops to walk the entire length of the canyon. Fun fact number six, if you fell from the height of the rim to the bottom of the canyon, it would take you 17 seconds to reach the bottom of the canyon, which count to 17 seconds. That's a long fall. Okay, last one, I promise. If the 2 billion years of Earth's history that the Grand Canyon represents was shrunk into one 24-second day, the carving of the canyon, the actual carving of the canyon, rather than the deposition of the layers and all, would have only taken place in the last 4 seconds of that 24-hour day. Hope you enjoyed this video about the Grand Canyon's amazing geology. If you want to hear more details about the Grand Canyon's geology, geologic history, and multiple hypotheses about how and when it was carved, I highly encourage you to check out Jesse and Chris's Planet Geo podcast and Camp Geo audiobook app. Chris and Jesse are the guys I had on for my oldest rock two-parter videos a couple of weeks ago. So I highly encourage you to go check out their podcast about the Grand Canyon. They talk about it in multiple episodes, hours and hours of amazing geologic detail about this amazing canyon. With that, references as well as links to their podcast and app are linked down below in my description box. And yeah, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye. And shales and some. Okay, that goes in the outtakes. Then the corals that lived and built reefs in the Paleozoic period. Ugh, it's not a period. Look at this beautiful weathering pattern in these rocks here. If you want to know what type of weathering this is, go check out my video on weathering and erosion, because I can't remember what it's called at the moment, but it's really cool. Look at these beautiful cross-bedding layers. This is so cool, and you can see it just cuts through right there. So I wanted to just stop here at this cliffside to show this beautiful transition of all the layers we talked about today. So we have at the bottom, you can see the more weatherable Bright Angel Shale of the Cambrian over 500 million years ago, then up into kind of the teeny tiny layer of mauve limestone in the Cambrian, up into the red wall limestone of the Mississippian, going now around 300 million years ago, then up into the Supai red rocks group, the Supai group of rocks, which represent the upper Mississippian, the Pennsylvanian, and lower or early Permian, nearing now 280 million years ago to 250 million years ago. If we go all the way up to the top of the cliff where we see this more tan stuff, the sandstones of the Coconino, the Kaibab sandstones, and other rocks. So then now we're all the way up to around 250 million years ago. So this cliff represents almost 300 million years of Earth history. And we can actually see this transition from more sturdy rocks like limestones and sandstones to the shale, the Bright Angel Shale. And you can see how the shale is so much more weatherable and less resistant than those layers, that it goes from this kind of red cliff to these darker, more sloping kind of hills. And this is just another way that we can kind of start to tell what kind of rocks are out there from a distance without actually getting up close to them to identify them.